Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship at Sugar Grove United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Tammy Scott. I hope that you know that wherever you've been on your spiritual journey, whatever your faith background might be, you're welcome, and we are truly glad to worship together this morning, those who are gathered here in the sanctuary and those of you who are joining us from home this morning on Facebook Live. I have a few announcements that I'd like to share this morning. The first is that we're wishing a happy anniversary to Tom and Diane this week. And then we have some birthdays as well. We're wishing happy birthday to Rita Fitzpatrick, Dennis Fitzpatrick, and Cassie Adams. We're also going to wish a happy belated birthday to Brian. He weren't here for us to say it last week, but I remember. So happy belated birthday. Are there any others celebrating a birthday this week that we don't know about? All right, we'll sing happy birthday to Cassie. Embracing this deeply human part of ourselves as we move together toward the great and joyous mystery of Easter and the resurrection story. So I hope you'll continue to join us for worship on Sundays at 10 a.m. here in the sanctuary or on Facebook. We are working towards transferring to YouTube. I think they offer a little bit more options for us, but we learned last week we cannot broadcast live to YouTube unless we have 50 subscribers. So if you have a YouTube account and you'd be willing to subscribe to the church's YouTube channel, keep an eye on an email or Facebook and those kinds of places. There'll be a link where you can subscribe. We doubled our numbers this week, but we're still only at about 25 or maybe up to 30, so we need a few more before we can switch to YouTube. Our mission of the month is collecting some of the most needed items for World Release Refugee Welcome Kits. You might remember that last fall, we collected items for those who were arriving into the Chicagoland area rather quickly, some emergency items that they needed. And those folks are now getting more permanently settled in the area, and so there's a need for some of these items that you see on the screen or in your bulletin. And so if you're able to bring some of those items, we would appreciate it. All items must be new, and we need those items to be here by the end of March so that we can deliver those to World Relief. Next Sunday, following worship, about 11:10, 11:15, all are welcome to join us for a St. Patrick's Day craft and story time. Miss Ellie Fuchs is working on a craft and a game that will be fun and meaningful for families, but also for people of all ages. So don't think this is just an activity for children. We really hope this will be an intergenerational all-church event next Sunday after worship. We have Easter lilies available to purchase in honor or memory of someone. You'll see an order form in your bulletin. If you would like to do that, you can put cash or check in the offering plate with the order form, or if you prefer, there is a link to an online form that you could use as well and even pay online if that's easier for you. And then I need to make sure that you know that one of my least favorite days of the year happens next weekend. We spring forward. Get ready to lose an hour of sleep. But make sure that you set your clocks ahead so that you're not late for church.
I'm excited.
You're excited?
I sleep so long.
Oh, good.
I like sleeping.
So just remember to spring ahead on those clocks next week. Now as we make the transition from gathering for worship to being in worship, I invite you to take just a few moments, find a comfortable position, close your eyes, breathe in deeply and allow your body, mind, and spirit to prepare to praise and worship God.
Good morning. Please stand as you're able for the call to worship. God's word is the Bible. God's word is the Bible.
When we doubt, we can turn to God's word.
When fears take hold of us, we can turn to God's word.
In times of joy, we can turn to God's word.
Jesus is God's word manifested in the flesh.
Thanks be to God for saving the word.
Please join me in the opening prayer. The words and the word.
How might we read your precious book we call the Bible as a roadmap, a manual, a trail of breadcrumbs, as a love letter, a symphony, and an invitation to dance? As we open the book, just what awaits us?
Amen. The opening hymn today is Lord, Speak to Me, number 463 in the big hymnal.
Yeah.
Not much kids? Well, we got some great ones. Okay, I have a couple of questions for you this morning. No. What books do you like to read? Ooh, all right, I love it. I'm going to start with the one that doesn't live with me. Run, Charlie. Which ones? Kara J. Stevens. Ooh, that sounds good. Okay, Hannah. Pixie Chicks?
Tricks.
Pixie Tricks. Okay.
Help us.
the joys of the Bible.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
All right, Lucas, you can take your Bible. And then I'm going to invite you to go back to your seats, and we're going to sing together, Thy Word is a Lamp. It's number 601 in your hymnals.
Indeed, the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And before him no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Will you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for this day and for this opportunity to be gathered together as your children, as your church. Open our hearts and our minds and our ears this morning, O God, that we might each hear the message that you have for us this day. For you alone, O Lord, are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. We all have a call story. It's a story of how God called us into ministry. Now you might be thinking, I'm not ordained, nor am I called to ordained ministry, so I don't have a call story. But I promise you that we all have call stories. Clergy are professionals at telling our call stories. This is in part because it's something that we talk about ad nauseum throughout our seminary journey and throughout the years of moving through the ordination process. A call story is the moment or moments that we begin to understand that God is leading us to do something. It might be a nudge or a whisper. It might be someone asking or inviting us to do something. It might be a voice that we hear or a vision that we see. My call story began when I was just 12 years old with a pastor identifying in me gifts that she thought would make for a strong and good pastor. And then when I was 16, I went to Explore 94. It was held in Richmond, Virginia that year. It was a conference that was held every few years with the United Methodist Church for young people who maybe were exploring a call to ordained ministry. And while I was there, there was a scripture that we focused on throughout the several days, and it was Isaiah chapter 6, verse 8, which reads, "Then I heard the Lord of the voice, Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send and who will go for us?' And I said, 'Here I am, send me.'" Even after leaving Richmond, that scripture stayed with me and informed me as I made decisions about helping to lead the youth group as a high school student in my home church. But I still wasn't ready to claim a call to ordained ministry. Then in college, I had a moment in worship during my freshman year where I saw myself standing in the pulpit of my home church and spent some time thinking about it, and yet I still wasn't ready to respond or think about actively pursuing a call to ordained ministry. My favorite hymn, though, became, "Here I Am, Lord." And the words of Isaiah continued to lead me and guide me until I did begin to accept my call as one who is called to ordained ministry and began seminary. In fact, in moments when I am feeling lost or uncertain or disconnected from God, those are the words that I still return to. "Whom shall I send and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here I am, send me." So I wonder, what has your call story looked like? How has God spoken to you? Who has God spoken to you through calling you to be in service to this church, to your family, to the community, to spread and share God's love? Many people, Christians included, are intimidated by the Bible. The text can be confusing and even shocking. It might surprise you, but then again, maybe not. It's actually quite normal to struggle with Scripture. In fact, I go so far as to say we are called to struggle with Scripture so that together we might better understand its wisdom. The Jewish tradition of reading Scripture, the tradition that Jesus and the disciples and Paul would have known, promotes active and lively debate so that all community members might better understand each other and the Bible. We need not fear or avoid disagreements about how best to understand a passage of Scripture. Instead, we can choose to embrace our roots and view disagreements as a healthy process that God uses to develop unity and consensus in communities of faith over time. Questions about the reliability of Scripture come from a variety of different places and different angles. For example, sometimes we hear questions like, "Is it historically accurate? Is it consistent with itself, or are there contradictions within it? Does or how does the history of translation affect the meaning of Scripture?" Whenever we address the reliability of Scripture, it's important to start by remembering what the Bible is reliable for. The Bible is reliable because it rests upon and points us toward the Logos, or Jesus, the Word of God. Jesus is the Word of God made flesh. Even though we often refer to the Bible as God's Word, it's important not to lose sight of how our tradition speaks about Jesus. Understanding Jesus as God's Word also helps us to better understand how the writer of Hebrews uses the term Word of God. The writer uses the Hebrew Scriptures, the Old Testament, to illuminate what God is doing in the writer's time and place. The persecution the writer's community is facing from the Roman Empire is being used by God to reveal the evil of sin and human sin and within the community of faith and their faith in Jesus. Ultimately, our high priest, Jesus, was also tested. Will pour out grace and mercy to those who trust in him. The writer compares what is happening in their own time and place to what has happened throughout the Hebrew Scriptures, the Old Testament, so that the audience can see themselves in those familiar Scripture words. But at the same time, the writer continually reminds them that Jesus is the one for whom all Scripture points, the ultimate Word of God for all humanity. Throughout the book of Hebrews, the author refers back to specific stories and characters in the Hebrew Scriptures and how they are connected to Jesus. For example, in chapter 11, the author retells the story of some of the characters that the children named this morning, Noah, but also Abraham and Moses and other Israelite heroes. And then in chapter 12, the author connects those stories to the example of Jesus. As the writer of Hebrews states, Scripture exposes us. God, through Scripture, can help us to see who we really are. We can look to Scripture to understand who we were created to be as part of God's story. And Scripture leads us to repent and to turn to Jesus. And so as we find ourselves in Lent, a period set apart each year for us to spend time reconnecting with God, focusing on our faith in new or maybe more sincere ways, reflecting on those things that we have done or should have done, asking God for forgiveness when we have strayed. Now is the perfect time for us to ask ourselves some questions about the Bible. Do we regularly engage the Word of God, the Bible? Do we seek guidance for our own lives and faith journeys in the stories found in the Scripture and in the life and ministry of Jesus? Do we tend to use Scripture to prove a point or to promote our own agenda? Are we using the Word of God to help us see clearly who we are and our need for God's grace? When we use the Bible for our own ends, we keep it from challenging us and drawing us into a deeper relationship with Jesus. When we make the Bible about us and not God, we also often drive others away from engaging in it. The existence of the Christian community for more than 2,000 years after the death of Jesus speaks to the power of the stories and the wisdom contained in the Bible. Your changed life is the greatest proof of the reliability of the Bible. Let me say that again. Your changed life is the greatest proof of the reliability of the Bible. So where do we go from here? For the last few months, I have set an exercise goal with my friend Bonnie. It began in December. We set a goal of a certain number of workouts in that month, and then we carried that over to January. And then in February, we decided to switch the goal, and we set it for a certain number of minutes of working out in that month. And in March, the same, though we increased the number of minutes since there are more days in March than February. But we check in with each other once a week or so to make sure that we are on track. And on Ash Wednesday, as I sat in this space, in between folks coming to receive ashes, I would get up and I would walk around the sanctuary, praying for all of you and for those who would gather in this place to praise and worship God. And I realized in doing that, I spend a lot of my day sitting. And so I decided to add a new goal for Lent, and that is to have 7,500 steps minimum per day. For some of you, that might not seem like very many, but I realized I was averaging about 3,500 to 4,000 steps a day as well. And so almost doubling that by setting a goal of 7,500 steps per day. Some days that means I have to force myself to get up and walk around the sanctuary. Donna came in the other day and I was doing some laps. Or maybe I get up and walk around my house and I'm longing for the nice weather. Maybe today I'll be able to go and do some of those steps outside. And perhaps as I do that, I can pray for the people that live in the houses that I'm walking past. I share this to say that we are only at the beginning of Lent. What if each of us set a goal for the season of Lent? Maybe it's reading a few verses of Scripture each day so that we are engaged with God's story and we are seeing ourselves reflected back in the story of God's people. Now, some of us are already doing that, so maybe it's an added layer of talking with someone about the verses you read or journaling about what God might be saying to you in those verses. Whatever seems like an appropriate or attainable goal for you to dig more into the Word of God in the next several weeks, I would encourage and invite you to name what that goal is and then to find someone to share your goal with, so that you can hold one another accountable and have a check-in time once a week and see how you're doing. I want to close with these words, a poem written by Steve Brown, and it's titled Hello Bible. Hello Bible. Yes, it's alive. It speaks to me. Hear the pure voice. Not like thunder, like a whisper. It beckons me. It's inspired. It draws me near. Speak to me now, the living word. Double-edged sword divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. Hello, Bible. It has quick feet. It pursues me, chases me down. It lights my path. It catches me, but now I'm free. Hello, Bible. It has strong hands, powerful grip like praying hands. Lord, carry me. Bear my burden. The word made flesh grabs hold of me, kneads and molds me, potter and clay. It lifts me up. It fills my cup. Hello, Bible. It has appeal. It draws me near, like a magnet, spiritual force, or a mirror. It is faithful, right, wonderful, everlasting, pure righteousness bred from heaven, take, eat, take, drink. It makes me think. Hello, Bible. It's alive. It lives and grows. Tell the whole world. It's pure as gold. Tentacles spread. It must be read. Friends, may we all spend time doing that this week and throughout the season of Lent, reading the Bible and listening for what God has to say to us in and through those stories and words. Amen. Lent provides us a time to do some different things, and one of those things is to focus on and maybe make changes to habits that are not in line with God's desires for us. And so one of the ways that we're practicing and living out our faith is by remembering what we believe and saying the Apostles' Creed together each week. And so I invite you to join with me as we say the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. On the backs of your bulletins, you'll see the list of people that we are praying for. We continue to pray for Lisa and Landon, for Christine, who is now home from the hospital, for Rich and Betty, for Jill Napanon's family upon the death of her father. We're also praying for Joe Wolf, who has been in the hospital this week. And would like to also add Michael Mayer to our prayer list. He'll be going to Mayo Clinic next week to have surgery, and so we hold Michael and his family in prayer as he prepares for that hernia surgery, and it's pretty complex surgery, but hopefully will go smoothly. We're praying and also provide him some relief from some struggles he's been having for a number of years. Are there other joys or concerns that you would share this morning?
My sister is having hip replacement surgery tomorrow, and our concerns are the many health issues that she has going into this.
Thank you. What is her first name?
Carol.
Carol. We'll be praying for Carol.
Thank you.
I'm going to write it down so I don't forget. Are there any others? Then let us pray. Lord, we come to you with lots of questions and concerns. At times we aren't sure that you will even listen to them, and other times that you will think our queries are foolish. We have made messes in this life, some of which we have cleaned up, but there are others that we have swept under the rug, hidden away in the closet, hidden from ourselves, and we believe hidden from you. But you know us better than we want to be known. You know our thoughts and actions. Help us, Lord. How can we turn things around so that there is peace and hope? We lift before you the concerns that we've shared, concerns for family, community, and nation. And yet we don't really expect that anything will change. We are unwilling to change ourselves. And so change for the world appears a wispy dream. Bring your presence powerfully to us. Convince us of the hope that rests in you alone. For this we offer in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for worshiping with us this morning, and thank you for all of the ways that you support the life and ministries of this congregation. The Bible talks a lot about how we use our money, our time, our energy. Jesus, the Word made flesh, is clear. No one can serve two masters. You cannot serve God and wealth. So you are invited to give as you are able today, not from a place of fear or shame, but from a desire to serve God with all that you are and all that you have. And Sheldon gives us or provides us an offering this morning. The ushers will come to receive our offerings. Thank you. All are invited to God's table. All are welcome to participate in the fullness of God's abundant, healing, reconciling meal. You do not need to be a member of this church or any church. All who desire to grow in their relationship with God through Jesus are invited to come and feast at this table. For those of you who are worshiping with us from home, please receive this as an invitation to have me come to your home or to plan a time when you can come to church to receive the communion elements as well. Lord, we know that you lead us and that you desire that we follow you closely. Your word is the guide for our life, but sometimes we use it to hurt other people. In this season of Lent, we take time together to pray a prayer of confession, and so I would invite you to join with me in our prayer of confession. God of light,
we appear naked before you.
The secret intentions of our hearts lay bare for you to see. We confess that instead of allowing your word to actively shape and transform our lives, we manipulate it to suit our own personal agendas. Convict our hearts of our sins, which are rooted in our desire to be masters of our own universe, ruling over others and possessing all things. Forgive us of our wayward actions and attitudes, O Lord. Free us from our double-mindedness and our efforts to remain in control, so that your holy word can lead us into life as true disciples of Christ Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Sisters, brothers, siblings, hear the good news. In Jesus, we have a great high priest who knows our weaknesses. It is in his righteousness we boldly stand before the throne of God. May we receive his healing mercy and grace. And now I invite you to turn in your hymnals to page 13 or follow along on the screen and join with me in the prayer of great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. It is right to give our thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. Before the mountains were brought forth, for you had formed the earth. From everlasting to everlasting, you alone are God. You created light out of darkness and brought forth life on the earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. When rain fell upon the earth for 40 days and 40 nights, you bore up the ark on the waters, saved Noah and his family, and made covenant with every living creature on earth. When you led your people to Mount Sinai for 40 days and 40 nights, you gave us your commandments and made us your covenant people. When your people forsook your covenant, your prophet Elijah fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, and on your holy mountain, he heard your still small voice. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Christ. When you gave him to save us from our sin, your spirit led him into the wilderness where he fasted 40 days and 40 nights to prepare for his ministry. When he suffered and died on a cross from our sin, you raised him to life, presented him alive to the apostles during 40 days, and exalted him at your right hand. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. Now, when we, your people, prepare for the yearly feast of Easter, you lead us to repentance for sin and the cleansing of our hearts, that during these 40 days of Lent, we may be gifted and graced to reaffirm the covenant you made with us through Christ. On the night in which he took himself up, on the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, Jesus took the cup. Again, he gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and from these gifts of bread and fruit of the vine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us join our voices together praying the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever. Amen. You'll be invited to come by the center aisle to receive the bread and the juice. If you need a gluten-free option, please let me know. We have that available. And then there are baskets to dispose of the cups if you like to consume here, or you're welcome to take it back to your seats as you return by the side aisles. God speaks to us in the silence, and God speaks to us in the noise. And God speaks to us in this meal. Listen and come, for the table is prepared for each of us. I've invited Addie to come and serve. And Judy, would you?
Thank you.
Please join with me in the prayer after receiving. Let us pray. Eternal God, we give thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Raise us to new life through this sacrament. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I'm going to invite Brian Adams to come and join me up front.
So my name is Brian Adams. I am the chair of the governing board for Chicago Methodist Church for about the last 5 years. Yesterday I got a phone call about 8 o'clock that I wasn't expecting. And it appears that Tammy has been reassigned to the Aurora Wesleyan Church. This is a great opportunity for Tammy. I'm very excited for her. This does mean changes for us as well, and we will set forth on those on that journey in the coming week. I knew this was going to be difficult for her to share with us, so I decided that I would, you know, share this news with everyone. With the Methodist way of going about things, we've had Tammy for about 5 years, and this is kind of the process for the church. And you know, it is sad, but you also have to think about the fact that this is a great opportunity. Tammy became, she started off not even able to do the sacrament of communion for us, and so she's grown with us, and this opportunity for her to grow with the new church is great, and I don't want it to be a sad time for us. I want us to focus on the opportunity for Tammy, and then we as a congregation will figure out what our next step is as well. So, you know, this is news that isn't easy to share, isn't fun to share, it's important that we all know and help Tammy with this transition as well. So, I don't know if you've got anything that you wanted to add, or if you have any questions at this point.
The transition doesn't happen immediately. I am still your pastor through the month of June. The new appointment will start on July 1st, and I have been so blessed to be your pastor. I am still blessed to be your pastor and for the way that you have loved me and my family. And I look forward to the next several months and the ministry that we still have to do together. And you will always be a part of my heart and my life, and I will be praying for you for whatever might be next here. But our work together is still not done. Oh, thank you.
I didn't let her know I was going to do this. She has this beautiful thing that she prepared for today, and I'm sorry.
That's all right. I'll come to you with an email. Because we'll need to let others know who are with us this morning. With that, I invite you to stand, and let's join our voices together in singing about the wonderful words of life, number 600 in our hymnal.
Thank you.
this place, filled with God's love and peace, and be the light of Christ to those you meet. Amen.
Amen.